when you're up on the mountain, and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But things change when you're down in the valley. Don't lose faith, you're never alone. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, He'll make them right. And the God of the good times.
Almighty God, I pray for this nation, O Heavenly Father, that all praise, Lord, season, Almighty God, that they will give you the praise that you deserve, O Heavenly Father. Open up our minds, open up our understanding to your will, to your spirit, to your love, to everything, Almighty God. Mighty God, you said you have given us the key, Almighty God, and whatever we bound on earth, it shall be bound in heaven, and whatever we loose on earth, it shall be loosed in heaven, Almighty God. Lord, some of us don't know the authority that we have, Almighty God, but help us to see, Almighty God, and to seek you, Almighty God. Heavenly Father, we pray for your people, that you strengthen them, Almighty God. Lord, you know what they're going through. Some may have lost loved ones. Some may have lost their jobs. Some may have just given up, Almighty God. But Almighty God, put your spirit of humbleness in them. Put your spirit of peace in them, Almighty God. Put your spirit of comfort in them, Almighty God, that they will know that you are always right by their side. You may be far, but you are there, Almighty God. You may be near, Almighty God, but you are there in their hearts. Heavenly Father, strengthen our minds as we go through each and every day. Let not temptation drag us down, Almighty God. Remember, Almighty God, we are your people. As we call upon you, Almighty God, for help, for there is no one that help us to do. Almighty God, for help coming from you, Almighty God. God, we just ask for strength. We ask for guidance. Continue to guide us, O God, that when we are alone, Spirit, you will fill us up. Almighty God, that our box of oil will run over, Almighty God. Heavenly Father, just have your own sweet way. For those who are sick, even more, God, let us be healed in the name of Jesus. That you are the great physician and the great doctor, that what you pronounce, Almighty God, it is done. Almighty God, that everything that we speak in the name of Jesus, it is well, and it is done in the name of Jesus. Have your own sweet way, Almighty God. Move within us, O God. Sweep across us, Almighty God. Let us feel your presence in the name of Jesus. Have mercy, O God, and have thine own sweet way, O God. In your name we pray.
I am a warrior, a Christian warrior, with the weapon in my right hand.
Warrior,
the Lord. No one can, no one will. And who can stand against the King? No one can, no one will. Oh,
Caribbean, the North American region, As we look on social media, we are seeing that there is so much opposition against the church, and in particular, the use of the name of Jesus. And I think what we need to do as a church, I'm asking the question, what has Jesus done to people? Why so hated? It must be the only person who hates Jesus is the devil. And so those who are haters of Jesus are workers of sin. And so we just have to push back in the name of Jesus. But as we pray, let us remember those who are hurting. Pray for Sister Keisha and family as they grieve. Pray for those who are hospitalized. Pray for those who are challenged and tested within the context of their marriages and relationships and family. Pray into the atmosphere that the satanic entity that is in the atmosphere, that by the power of God, we shall neutralize them in the name of Jesus. We shall neutralize them in the name of Jesus. Come on, church. Can we say in the name of Jesus? Come on, speak that name. Because that name is a name of victory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We bow down and worship Yahweh. We bow down and we worship Yahweh.
And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Come on, let us raise his praise. Come on, church. Come on, let us raise his praise. Come on, church. Let us break out of ourselves. We lose shackles in the name of Jesus. We break yokes in the name of Jesus. We speak to sicknesses and diseases in the name of Jesus. We speak to satanic entities that are at work in our church, in our community, in our family, in our nation. We speak into the atmosphere.
Thank you. Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, afterward he was hungry. Now when the tempter came to him, he said, "If you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread." But he answered and said, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him up into the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against the stone." Jesus said to him, "It is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God." Again, the devil took him up on an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, "All these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Then Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve." 11 and last, then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him. This is the word of the Lord, and we honor it by
it's great that we can be overcomers, and we can only be overcomers through Jesus Christ. Because humanly speaking, when we are tested, when we are challenged, it is so difficult. But with Jesus Christ, we are overcomers. Amen? We have been made victorious through Jesus Christ. We want to thank the young people for leading today and for executing. This time we're going to ask you to turn your Bibles again to the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 4, and as you know, we're in the period of Lent, and it's a 40-day period of prayer and fasting in which the believers over the years religiously try to deepen their commitment to the Lord. And so the series of sermons we do are really geared towards challenging people towards this end. And so we turn our Bibles to Matthew 4. Reiterate verse 1. Then was Jesus led of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. Let us pray. Father, open our eyes, our hearts, our minds, our thoughts. Allow us to see beyond the obvious, and that your word will bring life and light and transformation and healing in our lives. In your name we pray. Amen. And today we are talking about divine strategies for overcoming temptation. That is, divine strategies for overcoming temptation. And all of us are tempted. And if you're not tempted, you're either too Christian or you're too lying. Because all of us are tempted to do evil and to be drawn away from our faith. And so even Jesus himself was tempted and was made victorious. Because Hebrews tell us that he was in all point tempted as we are, yet without sin. That's the difference. That when Jesus was tempted, he did not yield. Amen. And so it's that temptation that is sin. It is healing. Yes, so the psalms say, "Heal not to temptation." Yes? Yes, so we have to be overcomers. Now the word temptation comes from the Greek word periazo, which means evil allurement to reveal weakness. So it is an allurement. You know what is an allure? It's more like a bait you put in a fishing pole to lure the fish to come. It is not real sometimes. It is artificial, but it looks attractive. And it lures the fish. The fish picks it up and realizes that he gets something that is not only artificial, but something that is a hook that holds it. and it becomes dinner in a number of cases later. So the word temptation from the Greek etymology and the origination of the word, it means an allurement to reveal the weakness. So the devil already knows your weakness, and so he tries to appeal to that weakness in you. As an example, the devil would never try to tempt me with smoking or drinking or party and gallivanting, because I've done that before in the earlier part of my life. So I don't have any need to go back and do that anymore. Amen. So there are certain things that the devil will not tempt you with, because that's not your weakness. If you love money, he will tempt you with money. If you love sex, he will tempt you with sex. Whatever is your weakness, the devil will appeal to it. And so temptation is an evil allurement to reveal weaknesses within someone. You therefore cannot be tempted by something if the weakness for it is not already inside of you. Okay, so if the weakness is not inside of you, and if you don't have that inclination and to do that thing, the devil is not going to waste his time on you, because he knows that don't waste your time doing that and try to get the person to do that, because that person is not going to do that. Amen. Temptation is always a means through which one's weaknesses, as I said, is appealed to reveal it. Now, in Hebrew, the Hebrew noun, masa, ordinarily translated as a temptation, as temptation, derived from the verb nessa, it bears out the meaning of trying, proving, and putting to the test. And so in the Hebrew understanding, it is when you are tempted or tested, it is either to reveal your character, to reveal your weakness. When you're tested, you're tested to reveal your character. When you're tempted, you're tempted to reveal your weakness. Now, the overall concept of testing and temptation from a Christian's perspective is to put one's ability to the test, to see if you will choose the good and reject the bad and the evil. Amen. So when you're tested, it is to see if you will choose the good. And the Bible tells us that Jesus matured in such a way that he was able to choose the good and to reject the evil. So if you are a weaky, weaky Christian, you do not have the ability, or a weak person for that matter, because not only Christians were tempted, other persons are tempted outside of the Christian community. So if you do not have the ability and the maturity to choose the good and to reject the evil, then it's a sign that you are weak in terms of your character, in terms of your spiritual life and journey. When the Bible speaks temptation, it is putting forth a situation in which one is given a challenge to choose between fidelity and infidelity, or faithfulness and unfaithfulness in relation to one's obligation to God. It is to test your faithfulness, because sometimes we say we are faithful, but when that faithfulness is put to the test, we crumble. Amen. So when you're challenged and tested and tempted, it is to test your fidelity, your faithfulness in the sight of Almighty God. The difference between temptation and testing is that temptation is an allurement to sin, while testing is God challenging us to make the right choice, choosing to obey him and not to disobey him. So, like when God tested Abraham, the Bible says in the Hebrew writing that he was tempted. But if you look at the connotation, it really means that Abraham was tested. So Abraham was tested to sacrifice his son. That, and it says God tested Abraham. God was not tempting Abraham. God was testing Abraham. And so at the end, God said to him, don't bother sacrifice your son, and provided him with a ram. Amen. But in the case of Joseph and Potiphar's wife, That was the devil working through that evil woman to bring down the man. Amen. And even when the man said, no, I am set here just to be the chief servant and not to be a sidekick for you, woman, the woman still insisted. And when Joseph refused, when Joseph refused, she tell lie on him, tear off his shirt and tell lie on him. And it says that at one point the Holy Ghost start barking at Joseph. Like the Holy Ghost start barking at Joseph, said like a bad dog. How can I do this wicked thing and sin against my God? And so when evil comes, brothers and sisters, and you see this kind of allurement to drag you down and to destroy your soul, you have to be under the power of the Holy Ghost enough to bark like bad dog. Shall we praise the Lord? Shall we praise the Lord? How can I do this wicked thing and sin against my God? Now God will test us, but God will not tempt us. For God does not tempt with evil. Amen? God does not tempt with evil. So there is no evil in God. So God is not going to tempt you with evil. God will test you. He will try you. He will try your faith. He will put your faith to the test. He will allow sometimes circumstances like Job. Job was tested, and God allowed the devil to test Job. And Job was tested to the extreme, where his wife said, curse God and die. I think that the devil and that the woman, amen, after she realized that the money ran out, amen, and she realized that the cow them dead, and she realized that the pig them dead, she said, well, what am I doing here? And said, when she looked at Job, and he was not all that attractive anymore. He looked mangy, like some little mangy dog, like what I saw at Mount Zion. And the woman said, what kind of man have you become? This a tree, you're just dead. Curse God and die. And Job, recognizing that this was a test, said, woman, you're a fool. You speak as a fool, because God will come out in the end. Because when you are tried and tested, in the end, you're going to come out as pure gold. If you're wood, hay, or stubble, you may burn up in the fire. But if you have precious stone, silver, and gold, you are going to come out. And when you come out, you're going to be purified. You're going to be stronger. You're going to be more determined. Shall we praise the Lord? You're going to be able to face the other challenges that are in your way. So that is testing. But in temptation, the devil wants to destroy your faith. He wants to destroy your relationship with God. He wants to destroy your integrity. He wants you to compromise your faith. But you have to realize when the devil is at work, because it's not every damn gargan, good teeth, damn gargan that is to come around. Amen. A skin on them teeth. Amen. That you must go after them. And vice versa. It's not even big, widey, and small ways, you see. You must run down. Because some of these things are satanic allurement. Amen. To bring it down and to destroy your soul. Amen. And you must know when the devil is working. You know, I told you about the pastor and his wife. Well, the woman like most women like to shop, because it is said that shopping malls and plazas were not built for men, they were built for women. Did you know that? They like to shop. Amen. Women like to shop. And while the man will just go there and look around and hold it for his arms and look around, the woman won't buy everything in the store. So she used to shop every other day, every week. She wants something new, like ambulance. Me want. And so the pastor said, honey, you don't realize the money is running out. You cannot shop anymore. Give it a month or two, and then you can buy some new dresses. And so, amen, she went to the store, and she saw this fancy dress. And she said, oh boy, I want this one. But then she remembered what the husband said. When the husband said, talk to her, she said, honey, you know, I know that the money is running down. But it is the devil who made me do it. So the husband, who was a pastor, said, honey, when you get there and the devil is tempting you to buy another dress, tell the devil to get thee behind you, Satan. And so she went in the store. She saw this fancy dress. And so she tried it on, although the husband said, don't buy anymore.
She tried it on. She looked in the mirror. She turned around. She looked at Ronnie and said, look good. Ronnie said, look good. Amen. Yes, I look good. Amen. And she said, what, I'm going to lay it away or buy it another month? She said, no, I have to buy it. So she pushed the credit card to the thing and purchased the dress. She went home, and the husband came home and caught her in the dress, trying it on in the mirror. And she said, I said, honey, another dress? And she said, my honey, I saw it, and I bought it. And she said, but I tell you what to do. She said, honey, the devil made me do it. But the husband said, but honey, I told you what to say to the devil. Get thee behind you, Satan. And she said, you know, honey, I did say that. I said, Satan, get thee behind me. And Satan went behind me and looked and said, honey, I'm from wrong as I look good. She ended up buying the dress. Shall I praise the Lord? So, brothers and sisters, when you are tempted by the devil. Amen. God does not tempt anyone. Hear what the Bible says in James 1 and verse 12 to 15. The Bible says, blessed is the person who endures temptation. For when he or she is tried, he shall receive the crown of life which God has promised to them that love him. Verse 13, let no one say when he or she is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempt he anyone. Amen. Verse 14, but everyone is tempted when he or she is drawn away after their own lust and enticed. That's what I'm saying, you know, that it is an allurement to what? Whatever weakness is already in you. So you are tempted when you are drawn away with your own lust and entice. Your eyes see, ears hear it, and you can't deny it and refuse it. Your belly wants it, or your body, and you go after it. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And so the Bible says, when everyone is tempted, when they are drawn away with their own lust and entice, in verse 15, then when lust is conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, it brings forth death. The analogy that is used here is like a woman who is conceived and become pregnant. And when lust is conceived in you, when you are impregnated with lust, you see something and you want it. You see something, it looks good. You see something, you have to go after it. You now become conceived. When lust is conceived in you, right? And lust is a desire to have something by any means, even if it is wrong or evil. You have it, you want it, you want to go after it. Amen. When lust is conceived in you, it starts to produce sin. Sin is like the baby, develop an embryo or fetus inside of you. It conceives sin. Sin is conceived. And after sin is conceived, it gives birth to death. And this death is a spiritual separation from God. As God said to Adam and Eve, in the day that you eat of this fruit, you shall surely die. It breaks the relationship and your sensitivity to God. So somebody just don't get up overnight and just sit and drop down. So something conceived in the heart, the desire conceived in the heart, and then it brings forth sin. And sin now, the devil knows once it is planted there, then there is this allurement that if you catch, once you grab the hook, you're going to become dinner. Amen? Shall we praise the Lord? Shall we praise the Lord? So then when lust is conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, it brings forth death. What James is saying here is that if you, or if we are tempted and come out of it, it will lead to a sure life, a deeper life, and a deeper relationship with God. But if we yield to sin, it, brothers and sisters, it is due to someone's evil predisposition within us, within themselves, that lure us away. Thus, brothers and sisters, you will become a statistic, spiritually speaking. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God will test you, but God will not tempt you to do evil. You get what I'm saying? God will test you, but God will not tempt you to do evil. Amen? Shall we praise the Lord? Shall we praise the Lord? God has no evil in him, right? For he is absolutely holy. He cannot tempt us with evil or to do evil. When you are tempted and you go after that which you're tempted to do, it is your own and Satan's own doing. God is not in the midst of it. Amen? Temptation comes from an evil desire, which we should resist by grace of God, because you cannot resist it by your own human ability. Because when evil is so potent in the world, temptation is so compelling that you cannot resist by your own human ability. You have to trust in the Lord's grace. Remember Paul? Paul said, I had a temptation, I had a weakness in the flesh. And Paul said, for this thing I prayed. And sometimes you pray about the weakness in the flesh, and it's like it's not going. Eh? The more you pray about it, it's more like it's a grow. And Paul said, I pray about this thing 3 times. And I said, God, do a surgery on me. God, take it out of me. And Paul says, when I prayed, Lord, remove this thing. Amen. He said, I give you sometimes. Sometimes God give us some things and other keep us humble. Shall we praise the Lord? Because if God never give you some things to keep you humble, you don't feel say you're God. Amen. You don't feel you're God yourself. So God give us this thing to keep us humble. So he says to Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. For when you are weak, then you are made strong. Shall we praise the Lord? So we overcome temptation not by our human ability, but by God's grace. It is by God's grace that we become overcomers. Shall we praise the Lord? Because sometimes, you know, the devil rise upon you and you say, I'm going to just tear out my shirt front and I should have just jump pants down here, so, and I could have just go bad. And he said, no, but me going go So you depend on God's grace. God's grace and mercy brought me through. I am living this moment because of you. I just want to thank you, Lord. And I want to praise you too, for it is your grace, Lord, and mercy that brought me through. Now let me tell you something. You ask, oh, are you going to go to heaven? It's not by your human effort, because it's not by your works of righteousness whereby you're saved, but by God's grace. It is God's grace that is going to take you into heaven. When you reach your extremity, and when you reach a place in your life where you can resist no more, just say, Lord, you take over. Amen. There's a song, Jesus take the wheel. Amen. You become the new driver in this life here. Because if God is not the new driver, you do some things, man. People, yeah, would have swell up to do a say, you do some things then. You know that? Shall we praise the Lord? But the grace of God, we resist God's, we resist the devil's temptation by God's grace. Shall we praise the Lord? Shall we praise the Lord? Let me hear you say, God, give me more grace so that I will be an overcomer. Come on, say that again. Lord, give me more of your grace so that I will become an overcomer. Amen. So the devil, brothers and sisters, when he appeals to the flesh, he's appealing to your carnality, your fleshy impulses, your fleshy desires. And these things are acting as a temptress to coax you, to cajole you, and to entice you to go against God's holy precepts. When we nurture instead of dismissing the evil desires, they will grow, for we will allow them to latch in the heart, and then it controls us. Anything that you nurture will grow. If you have a plant at home and you ignore that plant, it will die. But even through the drought, I was reaping peppers. You know what? Because every evening I get a wee water in the pepper tree there. Shall I praise the Lord? So I have nice catch bonnet peppers. If I just left them there, they would have died. But I nurture them. Now it is the same thing with evil desires. If they come in your head and they always start up here. Amen. If they get an idea and it comes in your head and you nurture that idea, it will grow and bear fruit. But if you dismiss it, and I always dismiss these evil desires by saying, Satan, that is your desire, not mine. That is what you want, not what I want. That's what you would do, that's not what I would do. And when I say those things, I notice it go away. But if I nurture it and cherish it, it grows and gets bigger. And then it will start giving away you can do it and strategies and how you can work it out. You have to rebuke him. Shall we praise the Lord? Once they come, you dismiss it. If you nurture it, cherish it, and live on it, and sleep on it, and dream of it, it becomes you. Can we praise the Lord?
Yes.
We are in Lent. Not true. Shall we praise the Lord?
Yes.
The resultant effect when we nurture these desires will be the loss of our spiritual beauty, the loss of our purity, the loss of our happiness, the loss of fellowship with God, and the loss of our credibility, amen, and our morality. Sometimes you never see some people going good, 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 and then see some things which lower them, amen, and they go after it. And when they go after it, they get trapped. And when they get trapped, they get destroyed. Because once you come out of God's will, and you're not walking in God's purpose, you're going to be destroyed, amen. But you have to fight. It's not saying that you cannot fail, you know. You're not saying you cannot make errors, you know. But if the devil backs you down, get up back and fight. Shall we praise the Lord? Don't just roll over and say, be dead now, God. Because little children, these things are written to you, that you sin not. But if you sin, you have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. Get up back and fight. Hello? Shall we praise the Lord? Because, brothers and sisters, to go to heaven is not food and dumpling to eat. It is hard work. So you have to commit yourself under the Holy Spirit power to control your life and say, Jesus, keep me near the cross, near the precious fountain, free to all the healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. And you have to be determined in the cross, be my glory ever, till the raptured soul of mine shall rest beyond the river. Shall we praise the Lord? So every day you get up, you have to fight. Every day is a war. Shall we praise the Lord? In the song we sing, Christian soldier, the war is on. You can't just sit down. You can't just stay home. You have to fight the good fight of faith. Stand up for Jesus. He's soldiers of the cross. Lift high the royal banner. You must not suffer now. You have to fight. Shall we praise the Lord? Because the devil comes through means, various means. Sometimes they come through your own church brothers and sisters then. Sometimes come through your spouses. Sometimes the devil comes through your siblings. Sometimes the devil comes through your children. Sometimes it is an evil neighbor. And sometimes it is an evil co-worker. Amen. Sometimes it is just some evil people that you have to encounter as you go on the road each day. And if you don't mind, you lose your soul. Amen. If you don't mind, you throw down the Bible and fight. But you have to remember who you are. And you have to remember whose you are. Shall we praise the Lord? You know, if I am going through YouTube, and I know the effect that women can have on men. Amen. And I'm going through and I see some very sexy, skimpy woman. I'm moving right along. Shall we praise the Lord? Because I'm not going to latch on it. Hey, I said, oh, Pastor, you can view that because you're strong, not me. Shall we praise the Lord? I don't strong in that way. Amen. So I'm moving right along. You get what I'm trying to say? So you have to be determined to fight for your soul. Amen. Fight for your salvation. Because the devil is fighting you. And when you're there, you know, when you're boxing in the ring and you're practicing and you're doing a little powder puff and you punch, but it's not a real one. And you're licking on the belly and it's not a when you punch in the face, but it's not a real punch. That's how some of us fight. Amen? But when the devil gives you a lick, it's a lick. I'm going to use the word, but it's a lick. What word would I use?
It's a lick if you kill you.
Shall we praise the Lord? You get what I'm trying to say, brothers and sisters? Amen. Paul talks about the struggles that he has, striving towards goodness and striving to resist evil. And he says in Romans 7, verse 19 to 23, I will just read some verses of that. He says, for the good that I would do, I do not. But the evil which I would not, that I do. You ever find that? That the good, how easy to do the bad and the evil. He said that the good that I would, I do not. Amen. Why Christian finds so hard to do the good? And he says, the evil that I would not do, that I find myself doing. Verse 20 said, now, if I do that which I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwells in me. You remember me talking about that evil impulse, that which is that weakness that is already in you? He says, if I do the good, the evil that I would not, it's not I would do it, it's that the evil that is already dwelling in you. And the devil knows that, and the devil appeals to that. Amen. Verse 21 says, I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. So every time you say I want to do good, evil is present. So you now have to reject that. Amen. And every time you say I'm going to do good, evil is present. Come on. Am I the only one who goes through this? Shall I praise the Lord? And every time you say I'm going to do good, evil jumped before I said present. Amen. But you now have to be determined that I've decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. Praise the Lord. No turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back. Praise the Lord, no turning. Said to the devil, that you can have the whole world. But give me Jesus. Oh yes, you can have the whole world. But give me Jesus. Oh yes, you can have the whole world. But give me Jesus. No turning back. Praise the Lord. No turning back. Amen. 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 So when the devil tempts us, he's appealing to the inherent evil desires that we are capable of. But Jesus' grace will sustain us. I want to close by sharing three strategies with you to overcome evil. Three strategies. Strategy one. When we are tempted, we must submit ourselves to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from us. Amen. We must submit ourselves to God. Resist the devil. You have to put up some resistance. There's a song of somebody saying, putting up resistance. You know that song? Yeah. Reggae song. So you have to put up some resistance. Amen. James 4 and 7 says, submit yourselves to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Simple. Submit yourself to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. He knows that if you resist him, he will flee from you. Shall you praise the Lord? James is simply asking us to fight back. Because you can't just let man come and beat you up so you don't fight back. Fight back for your soul. Fight for your spirituality. Fight for your holiness. Fight for your integrity. Fight for your life with God. Fight for heaven and the rejection of hell. You have to fight back. Come on, touch somebody and say, fight back. In the name of Jesus, don't give up that easily. Fight back. Don't become submitted and subjected to the works of the flesh and carnality. Don't allow the devil to win it over you. Fight back. In the name of Jesus Christ. And when the devil tempted Jesus, what did Jesus do? Did Jesus just roll over and dead? Jesus fought back. In the text we read from Matthew 4, downward, the Bible tells us, and when Jesus was led in the wilderness, verse 1, to be tempted of the devil, Matthew 4, and when the tempter came to him, he said, if you be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. You know, when the devil was doing this, Jesus was fasting for 40 days and 40 nights. What other thing to tempt him with? They was hungry. So the devil appealed to the hungry. Amen. Shall we praise the Lord? And that's why some people come out the line, because you want money and you want this and you want that, and the devil knows you want it. Amen. The devil know what you want, you know. Eh? And the devil know that Jesus, after 40 days and 40 nights, are some of you after you leave church today? You're wrong. Amen. Shall we praise the Lord? Not true. Amen. And so he said, what did he say? He knew Jesus' ability. He knew that in turn, fish multiplied fish and increased the bread. Amen. So he said, if you be the Son of God, if you be in your sin by the Son of God, because he didn't ever know him when attempting with that. If no one can do it, if you be the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. Amen. What a wicked devil. And we call it the lust of the flesh. Food, and tempt him with food. Turn these stones into bread. And Jesus says, give him the word. Let me say, when the devil come, you know? Give him the word. Touch your neighbor and say what? Give him the word. And Jesus says in verse 4, Jesus answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. When the devil comes to you, give him the word. When he tells you that you're going to die, and when he reminds you of your past, remind him of your future. Amen. Shall we praise the Lord? When he tells you that you're going to be defeated, tell him no weapon form against you shall prosper. Amen. Give him the word. Shall we praise the Lord? So Jesus gave him the word. Jesus quoted from Deuteronomy 8 and verse 3. Amen. Then the devil come again. Amen. And he said to Jesus, it is written again. He come to Jesus and said to Jesus, I want you to bow down and worship me. Or cast yourself from the temple. Took him up away from the temple. And he says, if you are the Son of God, cast yourself down. And the devil start to quote scripture to him. He will give his angel charge over you, lest you dash your foot against the stone. Jesus said unto him, it is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Deuteronomy 6 and verse 16. Amen. And then the devil come again, took him on the high mountain and showed him all the world. Can you imagine Jesus, who is the creator of the world? The devil is showing him the beauty of the world. And that is the lust of the eyes. When you see the thing, you go for it. The next one casts himself down, the pride of life. People like power and Superman. Everybody has Superman now. Everybody wants superpower, you know. Everybody wants ward off evil. They want yard ring. They want this. Everybody wants just wave magic wand and things happen. You know that? Then, so that is the pride of life. Want to say they are powerful. So Jesus said to him, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And then he took him up into the high mountains where he could see all of the beauty of the land. And he said, if I promise something that is not his. Yes. He said, if you worship me, I will give you all of this. Yes. Amen. Yes. I will give you all of this. You have some them coming like some people in the community. There was a man named Mark Simon in my community that when the people used to run the electricity, those high metal towers, they had some white men that came from overseas, and there were some forestry that was over the other side, because we plant a lot of yam. there. So looking at the fire street, could look like yam field. And my Simon would go over there and see all of those yam over there, they are mine. And if you just help me out with some money to buy fertilizer and yam stick, and when you come back, man, we just water you with yam. The forestry was talking about, my son, man, he's a genial little man. And the man said, what kind of yam was? This is a nigger yam, man. When you come back, I water you with money and with yam. Yes. Amen? Yes. All these are mine. Yes, that's what the devil was doing, taking other people's hand ashore. And I said to Jesus, if you bow down and worship me, I will give you all of this. And some of us leave the church, you know, because we get great and precious promises. And some of us leave Jesus Christ, you know, because the promises that have been given, the promises that have been given and made to us, them look attractive. But it is to destroy your spirit, destroy your relationship, destroy your soul. Sometimes it's not every job you must take. Yes. Because if it's your job that's going to cause you not to serve Jesus, don't take it. Hey. If you have a job that you have to sleep with the boss, don't take it. Yes. Amen? Yes. Shall we praise the Lord? Yes. So what did Jesus say to him? Then said Jesus unto him, get thee hence behind me, Satan. Yes. For it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord your God, and him only shalt thou serve. Amen. When the devil come, tell him in the name of Jesus, come on, are you? Come on, shall we praise the Lord? The blood of Jesus is against you. Take authority. Some of you just sit down there and get a box and go box and come back. Devil beat you up. And every day you come, you're weak like a guinea pig. Shall we praise the Lord? Fight back in the name of Jesus. Jesus fought back. That's how Jesus overcame. Come on, church. Come on, church. Shall we praise the Lord? Some of us, every little bang around, we in there. Every quarrel are gone, are we? Amen. Every cascas we in it. Every deep jam we in it. Come out of that in the name of Jesus. Take a stand and stand up for Jesus Christ. Make a difference. You are the light of the world. A city that is set up on a hill cannot be healed. You are the salt of the earth. Shall we praise the Lord? And if the salt has lost its savior, it is good for nothing but will be trodden under the feet of humankind. Come on, church. So stand up. Let me hear you say, fight back. Fight back in the name of Jesus. Fight for your salvation. Fight for heaven. Fight for your soul. You know, see the amount of evil in the world. Everybody wanted to compromise. They're locking up high school children now because they refuse to accept certain ideologies. They're taking out schools out of competition because they're standing up for Jesus. Amen. And as you travel, as you move around, you say, oh, we see it in Jamaica here. It's just a matter of time before we are going to be called upon to do the same thing. They're going to want to persecute the church, persecute the Christian, want to fight against the Jesus in you, but you need to fight back. Shall we praise the Lord? Come on, church, you need to push back. So, resist the devil. Amen? Amen. Submit yourself to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. The second point I want to make in terms of strategy, to overcome temptation, we must be sober, we must be vigilant. In other words, determined. In 1 Peter 5 and verse 8, it says, be sober, be vigilant. Because our adversary, the devil, is out as a roaring lion, walking about seeking whom he may devour. And if he see you as food, he's going to eat you. If he see you as food that he can eat, he's going to devour you. But the Bible says we must be sober, be vigilant, because the devil is out like a roaring lion during his surveillance. And said, that one they're weak, you know, we're going to catch him. The other one they're not serious about Jesus, we're going to catch him. You see, if you're serious about Jesus, are you the devil after, you know? If you bring everything to dissuade you, he's going to bring everything to discourage you. Amen? And if you see that he can't get you, he's going to devour you. Amen? But you must press along, saints. Press along, saints. Press along in God's own way. Shall we praise the Lord? Peter is saying because of the cruelty and the craftiness, the restlessness of activity of the enemy and the terrifying threats which characterize his effort to destroy our souls, we are encouraged to oppose his temptations with a steadfast loyalty to Christ and with unshaken constancy of faith. I pledge allegiance to the Lamb. With all my strength, with all I have, I will seek to honor his command. I pledge allegiance to the Lamb. Because the devil is consistently working. And if he tries something and it doesn't work, he's coming back with something else. If he see a move forward, he's going to try to twist something. And sometimes he's polite. And sometimes he fixes it up nice to make it look good so that you can grab it. But in the name of Jesus, be consistent. We must not be ignorant, the Bible says, of the devil's devices. Because he has many devices that he uses. And he uses them, and if his system can't work and catch her this way, he ground the other way and come back just because he wants to catch her. But we must not be ignorant. We must know when I see it and I work. When somebody has speak to you, you must know when I see it and I speak to them. Amen. So we must be sober. We must be vigilant. Because the adversary, the devil, is out like a roaring lion. And sometimes you ever send people in your life, you know, yes. I shake them and go shake your feet. But the power of God must rise up in you and say, Satan, I rebuke you. The name of Jesus Christ. You know, like our pastor, the last point I want to make. To overcome temptation, we must pray that God will lead us away from it. Shall we praise the Lord? Lead me away from it. In Matthew chapter 6 and verse 13, Jesus, in the prayer that he taught his disciples, he said, when you pray, you must pray, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Lead us away from temptation. So sometimes you can, from a human perspective, walk into something and you don't know. But when you pray, Lord, lead us away from temptation. When you're doing certain things and going certain places, the Lord will say, no, go down with me. Nobody go down with me. Tell them you can't come. Tell them another day. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Because a lot of evil in the world. It is so evil that you can't feel it. You have to pray, Lord, not into temptation, but deliver us, Lord, from evil. And as a pastor, you have to pray that prayer daily. Because of a lot of evil. And sometimes people put evil in your way. Amen. Sometimes people are fling hook after you too. Shall we praise the Lord? But you have to say, Lord, lead me not into temptation, but deliver me from evil. Shall we praise the Lord? Shall we praise the Lord? Lead us not into temptation is a prayer for God's providential help in our daily confrontation with the temptations to sin. We are in a constant battle for the preservation of our souls, and we must continue to fight, use the strategies in the name of Jesus. Let us battle for the preservation of our souls, as I said before, our health, our families, our relationship with God, and let us fight to win in the name of Jesus. Don't fight to lose. Fight to win. For Christian soldiers, the war is on. Stand on your feet with me. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for speaking to us. We thank you, O God, for preserving us through your grace. Because as we are faced with the challenges of life, sometimes we are tempted to give up. There are so many of us who live in evil daily and live on the periphery of the fence. We are religious, we like the Christian thing, but oh God, the compelling powers of hell keep dragging us back into sin. Help us to fight, Lord, so that we may enter into your kingdom. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
when you're up on the mountain, and you've got peace of mind.